Yes, ma'am, you can start now. Go ahead. Thank you.
Please ensure that Dwarka sir is there, ma.
Morning, sir.
Good morning, Dwarkanath sir.
Morning, sir. How are you, sir, madam?
Yeah, fine, fine. Back to college, yeah?
Okay, sir. Yeah. At the internal mass member, sir, giant.
Sir, Dwarka sir, we are in live.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. We are in live.
Yeah. We are in live. We are going to start the program.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, namaste and great morning to all the delegates. Today on the screen we have our principal Dr. Niranjan sir, today's chief guest Dr. Dwarkanath Reddy sir, and today's expert speaker Dr. Rajkumar sir. And I welcome you all to the day two of 3-day EFTP program organized by Seven Hills College of Pharmacy in association with APTI State Branch AP. I personally welcome you all the delegates and the teaching fraternity who are associating with us from the day one of our FDP program. We, the Seven Hills College of Pharmacy, always strive hard to impart equality education in pharmaceutical field. The internal quality assurance cell of SHCP was established in 2018 and was striving hard to find a better solutions to the imparting of quality pharmacy education. We have our own benchmarks to establish a good curriculum and also to pave a better path for the students. And also in this COVID-19, we are practicing a new learning management systems that is Moodle to establish all the students and also to maintain the academic integrity. With this short note, I request Dr. Niranjan Babu sir to give you his inaugural address to the day two of 3-day EFTP. Thank you, sir. You can take over the session now for the welcome note.
Om Namo Venkateshaya. Namaste. Good morning. Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. Dwarkanath Reddy, Annamacharya College of Pharmacy, Rajampet, Andhra Pradesh. Respected resource person of the day, Dr. Rajkumar, Deputy General Manager, SLV, Mumbai. Respected principals, teachers, delegates of the entire session, my dear friends, I give you a warm welcome for everyone present in this session. The second day webinar of FDP, I ensure the webinar will be useful and the next hour will be enjoyable and fruitful for everyone. Thank you very much. Good day. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wishes. Always we'll follow you in imparting a good pharmacy, good education in pharmacy. Thank you so much for that. And now I request our director, Dr. Uma Maheshwar Rao, sir, to introduce our chief guest, Dwarkanath Reddy, sir, to the delegates. Sir, Uma Maheshwar Rao, sir, you can carry on the session now.
Yeah. Very good morning to all of you. It's my great pleasure to introduce today's chief guest, Dr. Dwarkanath Reddy Garu. Sir is having 15 years of experience in the field of pharmaceutical sciences and currently holds a position of a professor in Annamacharya College of Pharmacy, Kadapa. He has received Vidya Ratna Award by the Academic for Health and Educational Growth on 17th December 2012. To his credit, Sir has been awarded as Global Award from Aeropath Academic Excellence from the Institute of Scholars, Bangalore. Sir has published nearly 50 national and international journals with a great impact factor of 1 to 5. And Professor Dwarkanath Reddy Garu rightly guiding 6 PhD students under JNTU. And he has received to his credit several fundings from the funding agents like DST, NIMAT, conduct experiments in pharmaceutical sciences. It's my great pleasure to invite you, sir, for our program. I sincerely thank you for attending this program as a chief guest for this today's program. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Umamaheshwara sir. Dwarika sir, it's over to you. You can just give your vision for our program, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Umamaheshwara garu.
Yeah.
Hello.
Dwarika sir, you can carry on, sir. You are in line. You can carry on.
Yeah. So good morning, all dear morning. Delegates. Those who are attending for this EFDP, which is organizing by Seven Hills College of Pharmacy, Tirupati, in association with APTI, Association of Pharmaceutical Teachers of India, AP State Branch, and I congratulate to the management, Madam Garu, and Niranjan Babu sir, and convener of this program, Sujitha Garu.
Thank you, sir.
And Raj Kumar Garu, as well as Priyanka Garu, who are hard work and sincere dedication towards to success of this 3 days events. Vidwan Sarvatra Pujyate. Vidwan Sarvatra Pujyate. The person who is having a king, he is appreciated and respected in this only his kingdom. If suppose the person who is having a more money, he is respected only in his village. Suppose in the person who is having a educated, then he is respected to throughout worldwide. It's a globally he is a respectable person. That respect is given only by an education. That education is given by teacher. So that is the value of teacher. All we are in the teaching field and all we are in the a good position in the society. The world which is run by everything on educated people only. So nowadays everything will be in the hands of educationalist, and if a good educationalist in the society, then the society will be having a excellent and the growth will be having a more. So in this reason I am really congratulate to the Niranjan sir, who is organizing this faculty development program. It's my privilege and honor to guest as chief guest of this program, which is organizing by EFDP, Seven Hills College of Pharmacy. It's my honor and indeed and as well as deed, which is as I am standing in front of you today. So really I'm thanks to the Sujitha garu for to take this concept theme of the biopharmaceutics, and which is having a very important role for drug development and new drug discoveries role. Biopharmaceutics play an important role for throughout completely and relevant to the drug discovery development. It's a heart of the main discovery and development, drug development and processing. And I am appreciating for the APTI who is initiating and come and collaboration with you to organizing this program. This is very important and golden opportunity for the students and staff members and all research scholars and as well as all participants. Because of if in this pandemic situation, it's very difficult to getting a knowledge and also update of information which is useful for important for the faculty members. So the main concept of this EFDP they are providing for to learn something about the which is having a important aspects related to the pharmaceutical science and as well as which is useful to the and current knowledge. And I request and advise for the all the staff members, those who are attending for this EFDP, please update your knowledge and share your knowledge to your students. So if you are earning a current knowledge, then that can be useful to the for society. So and I'm requesting for the all the faculty members, please attend for the various webinars and faculty development programs which is organizing by this college. And please update your knowledge through with help of an Swayam. So I think you know very well about the Swayam is one of the best platform to learn a lot of things, information from the as teaching learning methods and teaching techniques and evolution methods, and as well as remaining various aspects. So not only for these programs you are attending, please update your memberships for like professional body memberships, number of APTI, IPA, IPGA, Indian Pharmacy Association, number of pharmacist associations are there. They are sending one booklet for you and update knowledge, which is having a publishing by number of APTA will publish IJPER and IPA publish Pharma Times. So these all books which is help for your update of your knowledge. And my sincere advice for all the staff members, those who are attending for here, so please apply for research projects. Number of research projects are available. So if you got a good knowledge on the research aspects, then that is useful to the students and organization. So, and as well as number of DST projects, DBT, AACT, and recently in the Department of Science and Technology, they offered an eFDP program, online FDP programs with the cost of 1 lakh rupees they are sanctioned, and eFDP and as well as women's entrepreneurship, they having a recently they offered by DST programs. Please watch everyone and you learn a lot of things. So, and I requesting for the all the staff members, please be behaving as friendly like your students, and you are collaborate, you discuss with anything for their problems, and to share your knowledge to your students, then the students will always remember your name up to this life ending, because of we are guru and our responsibility, we should be remembered and we should be follow the ethics. If in case of you are not follow the ethical values and ethics, how you say for the students? The students should be having a, you are a right rule, you are a role model for the students. So that's why you should be having a getting a good knowledge, and that should be shared to the your students. So thank you, sir. A small few words which is given by opportunity for me to as a part of this wonderful event of and organizing by Seven Hills College of Pharmacy, Niranjan sir. I appreciate once again for Niranjan Babu sir to grand success of this event. So thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for your best wishes. Really, it was very great. And truly, we will do some hard work in pursuing our career in our research in the next future days. That's what the intention we have conducted this EFDP program also, sir. Thank you so much for your best wishes once again. And now I request Dr. Rajkumar, sir. My sincere welcome to you, sir, Rajkumar, sir. Now I request my colleague, Dr. K.S. Priyanka, madam, to introduce today's expert speaker, Dr. Rajkumar, sir, to our teaching fraternity. Madam?
Yeah, ma'am.
It's good morning.
Yeah, very good, warm, good morning to everyone. In this very pandemic situation, please stay positive, stay strong, and stay calm. And I am so privileged to read a CV about Dr. Rajkumar, sir. At present, sir plays a very pivotal role as a deputy general manager in USV Limited, Mumbai. And going through the educational qualification, sir has did his B.Pharm in JKMMRR College of Pharmacy and M.Pharm and PhD from Government College of Pharmacy, Karat Shivaji University, Kolhapur. And sir's career growth and sir career chat is inspiration to a lot of the youngsters. Sir had started his career in 2000 as a medical sales representative in Ferring Pharmaceuticals. From that to now, sir's commitment towards the pharmaceutical field is a very good inspiration to all of us, sir. And from 2003 to 2012, sir did as executive in the R&D, senior executive and manager, and as a head for FDC Limited, Mumbai. And from 2012 to 2014, sir has did as deputy manager and senior deputy manager in the Center for Excellence in the Dr. Reddy's Laboratories. And from 2014 to 16, sir has did in Sun Pharma, Sun Pharmaceuticals Private Limited, Vadodara, as a manager and functional head and senior manager. And these all are the key roles what sir has played up until the 2019. In 2019, sir has taken his role as the deputy general manager for USV Private Limited, Mumbai. And in sir's credit, sir has 23 patents and has a very good chapter in a Springer International Publications, Switzerland, and has got 24 international publications and 100 national presentations and 6 international and national conferences. reading your CV is so, I'm so privileged, sir. You are so inspirational for all of us where we are seeking to just attend. We are going to submit for IPR, sir, from our college. You are just a motivation and inspiration for us, sir. Thank you so much.
Madam, thank you, madam. Thank you for your nice introduction. Rajkumar, sir, you can take over the session. Hello.
Good morning, all.
Good morning.
Am I audible? Hello. Am I audible?
Hello, sir. You are audible, sir. Yes, you are audible. You can continue, sir. You can continue. You are audible.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank college management, principal, and organizing committee members for choosing me to talk about my expertise in computational biopharmaceutics. I would like to thank the participants as well for allocating your time to be here for this FTP program. Today, my topic is computational biopharmaceutics. It's a mechanistic PBBM, that is physiological based biopharmaceutical model for virtual bioeclants. So the roadmap today is, can somebody put presentation?
Yeah. Sunil? Dr. Sunil?
So what I'm, let me continue for the time of this. Today what I'm going to discuss is about the pharmaceutical quality and how to build the pharmaceutical quality in designing, development and manufacturing stage, and what is the application of in silico, in vitro, in vivo methods to attaining the very good quality product along with the safety and efficacy. And at the center of the, center of the bull, how this particular biopharmaceutics and computational biopharmaceutics along with the virtual bioeclants helping to build the product with more mechanistic and theoretical basis of pharmaceutical product development. Next slide, please. So today's roadmap is something like that. We are going to discuss about the pharmaceutical quality for designing, development and manufacturing, and in vitro, in silico, ex vivo and in vivo methods, then PBBM model and summary. Next slide, please. So the concept of the drug development and drug discovery process begins with the lifestyle modification. Whereas somewhere around 2000 years before, preferably in India, we have number of herbs which are used for the treatment of various diseases and disorders in those days. Because of the environmental change, urbanization and sedentary lifestyle, and the socioeconomical influences in terms of, the free to access the food, free to access the drinking water, and sedentary lifestyle, and we have all the the modern gadgets, devices, vehicle, which resultant in the number of diseases. The diseases called as endemic diseases, that is a very interesting thing. The endemic diseases resulted in the late 1970s, whereas in India it is picked up in 1990s. So one of such a chronic prevalence of diseases such as cardiology, for example, myocardial infarct and the angina pectoris and congestive heart failure and so on, And in endocrinology, the major thing is that I mean to say the diabetes mellitus, which is also a very very old disease which is reported in somewhere around 1,000 years before in some of the Chinese literature. But still, the diabetes for us in Indian gene now it is called as a proactive. It is the diabetes is more with the Indian gene. However, the diabetes is a major problem as on today because India is known for diabetic hub, and 2/3 of the people are with the diabetic. So, the emerging concept of India is known for the generic hub. That means, by volume we are major contributor for the generic drug across the globe. We are exporting a number of generic products, including the essential and lifestyle modification.
Excuse me, sir.
And so on.
Hello,
so,
sir.
The thing is, yeah. Hello.
Sir, just. Adjust your mic, sir. Your voice was not clear.
Now it is clear. Hello. Now it is clear. Hello.
Hello.
Now it is clear.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello, sir. Rajkumar, sir. Sir, you are mute, sir. Just unmute it.
Now you can able to hear me. Now you can able to hear me. Hello.
Sir, we can proceed, I think.
Now you can able to Thank hear you, me. Sir. Hello. 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 Hello, you can able to hear me now?
Yes, sir, we can hear you, sir.
Dear delegates, just a couple of minutes. Dr. Rajkumar sir is again resuming back within a 1 minute. Just be patient and regret for the inconvenience caused. Thank you so much. Yeah, Rajkumar sir. Hello, sir.
Hello, you can hear me now?
Exactly, sir. Perfect, perfect. You can carry on, sir. You can carry on.
You can hear me now?
Yes, sir. Perfect, sir. You can carry on.
Okay. Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry for disturbances. Some problem happened. Okay. Now we will start this. Yeah, thank you very much. I'm sorry for the delay. India is the generic, market. It is a generic based industry, especially in terms of pharma. I mean to say is that the safety, efficacy and quality of the generic products being challenged in over the past 30 years when the concept of generic came in 1984 after the introduction of Hatch-Waxman Act. Next slide, please. So the conventional analytical procedures. So one of the major goal of developing a generic formulation is achieving the safety, efficacy and quality of the drug products being manufactured, being designed during the research and development stage, and as well as the manufacturing side. So one of the major objective is that the pharmaceutical quality of the products being manufactured is continuously monitored. And this is the initiative from the ICH and all the regulatory agencies across the globe. So the pharmaceutical qualities generally in past, it was a kind of pharmaceutical quality like it is a kind of aligned with the manufacturing process. That means current GMP process. So the current CGMP pharmaceutical quality will give only the idea of about the manufacturing quality, but it is not a patient-centric pharmaceutical quality. So the concept of whatever the QC methodologies, whether it may be a dissolution assay and a disintegration and so on, like microbial load, these are all related to the pharmaceutical quality, whereas the patient-centric pharmaceutical quality is something very different that needs to be built. Now, the role of biopharmaceutics and pharmacokinetics to be in place to understand and to develop a product which should have the patient-centric pharmaceutical quality. Next slide, please. Ideally, while developing the product in R&D stage, the biorelevant in vitro methods such as a dissolution, diffusion, lipolysis, IVRT studies are widely used, like a kind of buffer ranging studies, pH studies, although pH ranging studies are widely used. However, in last two decades, since 2000, it attained a great, great intention, great impact because of the power of computers and simulation experiments. Because in those days, it is very difficult to develop the model for the longer period of time. It takes sometimes 2 to 3 months to develop a single model. But because the power of computation, we can able to develop the model very rapidly. So what generally the traditional methods are, they screen for 10 to 15 different in vitro methodologies. And they go for one pilot bio study based on the pilot bio bioequivalence or bioavailability studies. They come back and see what it happens, how, which method is the best suitable method. So that particular dissolution method should reflect the critical material attributes such as particle size, polymorphism, density, and so on. And same time, it like a critical process parameters, such as granulation, efficacy, and fluidization, mixing, all those things. And based on the CQAs, CPPs, and your in vitro relevancy to the bio, people generally the design space, which will offer you SUPAC level 1, level 2, level 3 changes while manufacturing changes are required, especially when we are changing the APIs, API vendor, API particle size, and sometimes API polymorphism. And the other thing is that the manufacturing site change and all those things needs to be titrated. Next slide, please. So this is the heart of today's presentation. The center, this is once again your 2010 AAPS Physical Pharmacy and Biopharmaceutics group. There was a kind of workshop on QBD and biopharmaceutics. This workshop, it was, you know, we were also part of the this AAPS Physical Pharmacy and Biopharmaceutics group, wherein everybody put their comments and thought process on how to build the pharmaceutical quality. That means quality by design based on the biopharmaceutical perspective. Here, the biopharmaceutical perspective is nothing but the patient-centric. So if you see the outermost layer of the circle is knowledge sharing and database. It's what the database is having. Suppose if at all I want to go ahead with a kind of molecule search, I get number of molecules, and it's preclinical, in vitro, in situ data, and ex vivo study data, then metabolism, on all whatnot, you know, related to formulation, patient-centric, clinical, pharmacodynamic, all those things. From the knowledge pool, just doing data stacking and data mining activities and data analytics, we built a mechanistic understanding of in vitro, in vivo. The mechanistic understanding, what we are building based on the literature, is also called as a hypothesis testing. And this hypothesis testing based on the literature data can be augmented with the in silico tools. For example, if at all, if the molecule has kind of blood-brain barrier permeability, then it is obvious that people know that the heterocyclic substitution of fluorine and chlorine, which results in the polarization of the blood-brain barrier integrity, and hence it enhances the brain targeting efficacy of that particular drug substances. However, this is the mechanistic hypothesis, which is based on the literature. But when you bring the in silico methodologies, then in silico methodologies will pool the number of compounds which are available in the public domain related to the similar structure and their blood-brain permeability in blood-brain barrier permeability, and it develop a kind of correlation wherein it will involve a lot of covariates, wherein you can go for further thin slicing, and you can get exact knowledge about your data, your drug substances or drug product or technology without before doing the experimentation. That is very, very important. Then the modeling and simulation came into thing. Then based on that, we can put the manufacturing controls. In terms of R&D, we can put the controls for reject or accept the particular lead libraries and all those things. It is possible. So the center is the patient, the outer is something like a knowledge. Then how we are integrating the biopharmaceutics for risk assessment and quality risk assessment, not only in terms of quality risk assessment, and also because we can go ahead with like a kind of failure mode of effective analysis, wherein you will get an idea how to get it into the ideal drug candidate or drug product for that particular targets. And here one very interesting thing, if at all if you have a kind of PK/PD correlation, then you can able to find from in vitro to PD to clinical outcomes are possible. That is called as clinically relevant in vitro methodologies. That is also emerging area of in vitro methodologies, which are very relevant to the clinic. Now, next slide, please. So, for the being to get the understanding, because many people work in a different platform, some people in drug discovery, some people in drug development, some of them are in manufacturing, some of the in LCM, life cycle management. The idea of the fundamental basis for biopharmaceutics is to understand the product, not only physically, chemically, physicochemically, mechanically, and physiologically, pharmacologically, you know, all the aspects, it's a layer by layer understanding the product. And we should have a kind of when you are in a design stage, when you are having, you have to have a critical materials or critical quality attributes, which is derived from, once again, a critical material attribute and critical process attribute. And you have to find out what is the critical attribute. The critical attribute may be a dissolution, maybe the reduction in tumor size, maybe it may be reducing the blood pressure, or it may be the concentration which should be lower to devoid the, I mean to say, the toxic effect. So the critical attributes to be identified, that is what the statistical basis of the decision making play an important role. That means if you have a right critical quality attribute, then you have a right problem of statement. Then to validate the problem of statement, you should have a reliable, reproducible, and characterized method. Suppose I know very well my attribute is I want to have a 20 publication. That is my attribute. Then that particular attribute is linked with what are all the pre-requirements, what are all the methodologies to achieve that my targets. And after that, once if you are committing to do all the things, we will get the end result. From end result, we have to validate once again whether there is a relationship between the in vivo or the target versus critical quality attribute. If there is a relation, probably maybe a linear, non-linear, and transformations, whatever the methodology if you are using, then if there is a relationship, then probably the material attributes are right, process attributes are right. In statistical terminology, your all the factors and variables are right to get the desired response. Here nothing but you put number of variables and you want to optimize the desired response for that. Next slide, please. So in manufacturing and life cycle management, this is the only differences is between this is previously in development state, you should have a reliability, but you have to have a standardized method, which should have a, the boundaries and yes or no, or whatever the, specifications are very important for manufacturing and life cycle management. The designing and synthesis of the specification of any tool is once again based on the number of data points you are analyzing. So this is the very, very fundamental and very important of developing a model. That means you should have you should know what is your response. Your response is a drug release, or your response is no drug release. Your response is what in terms of maybe pharmacological, maybe pharmaceutical, maybe toxicokinetic, whatever it may be. You should have your response and what are all the variables, maximum likely possible variables which influence the response you need to identify. So when we come back to that, there are number of parameters during the drug development and the drug discovery process or complex formulation and format of device drug combinations. Number of formulations, next slide please. Number of things will get influenced. One such a thing with the very, very less effort, I mean to say, you put a less effort and you get the maximum benefit. That means understanding the drug substances. Most of the people, they don't know, they are understanding their drug substances appropriately. That is the reason they fail almost 60 to 70% of the time. how to understand the drug substances. For example, chemistry, people know about chemistry and what are all the carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, and all the elementals and molecular weight and all those things. But biopharmaceutically, the structural property relations are very important. The structure will imply some kind of properties, which is very, very important, which is close to the compound's physicochemical property of the molecule, especially like log P, log D, pH dependent solubility in different states, and how it is influencing. And there is a rotational bond, probably maybe due to the polar surface area. One can ask the question, how the polar surface area will influence the efficacy or toxicity. That is the beauty of model development. We will see, layer by layer, how this is going to impact. And some of the structural property relationship, such as solubilization rate constant, such as wettability, such as the melting point, can be modulated by using appropriate risk assessment strategies. But whereas some of the properties are inherent, it is very difficult to modify. In those cases, we have to either synthesize or we have to compromise that, and we have to have a complementary formulation development to mitigate those properties. For example, these are all, next slide, please. These are all some of the structural properties like hydrogen bonding, polar surface area, lipophilicity, shape, molecular weight, pKa, solubility, permeability, and biochemical properties like metabolism, protein tissue binding, transportation, and binding affinity with KakO2 cell, and permeability with KakO2 cell, efflux transport system, and expression of multi-drug resistant gene. Everything is possible today using a computational biopharmaceutics or in silico tool. Even we will go through one case study wherein we can able to, without any experiment, we can able to do the, we can able to generate the pharmacokinetic profile of that particular molecule. Next slide, please. Next slide. These are all the some of the in silico tools which are available. Some of them are freely available. For example, EpiSuite is freely available, and some needs to be purchased. Spark is freely available. Some of them are you have to purchase. Admet and CLogP is one of the very good software, and Chemoxon is once again a very, very nice software. Admet Predictor is using some extent, but if at all, that depends upon your need and your base. This is once again a very, very big area. Which algorithm, which software, which in silico tool I have to choose for my thing. So that is the another. Next slide, please. Next slide. This is one of the case study wherein it is a gastro plus. It is a once if you are getting a kind of chemistry, the chemistry is 391 Dalton molecular weight product, which is having it's a weekly basic drug, that's the reason you can find the higher solubility in acidic pH. Sorry, go for case study one. Go back to the previous slide. So this is the the available information is molecular weight, chemistry. From chemistry, predicted log D, pKa, and KakO2 permeability. And the solubility study, solubility studies are also the in silico solubility studies. In silico solubility studies profiles were done. For example, when we done the top of the graph, when we modeled solubility, when we made it and we predicted the top of the plasma drug concentration, it is very, very under predicted. The peak is very, very small, whereas the predicted is very high. Then what they have done is that there is a kind of small tweaking which has been done in the software. That is what actually they generated the in-house experimental solubility data. They computed the in-house solubility data with in silico solubility data. Then there is a best fitting observed. This is the case study wherein if you have the compound chemistry, I mean to say you know the structure of the U compound, you can attain that like this. You are not comfortable, then you can able to get it. Okay, next slide, please. This is the PK sim. PK sim, for example, this is the one molecule wherein you can put all the datas, like data like a population. In population, you can put male, female, demography, weight, height, body mass index, then compound properties like molecular weight, pH dependent solubility, pKa, log P, permeability, rate constant, all those things you can put. One of the very interesting thing after compound is that you can go for the physiology. In physiology, you can change the two changes. One is the anatomy. Suppose if the different anatomies were found, then you can able to make the different anatomy. For example, the case is that gastroegectomy is having the abnormality in anatomy, and so that you can able to make it the model for that. And otherwise, the anatomy you can keep constant, and you can change the physiology. Physiology you can change the vascularity, and depends upon the disease, depends upon the ethnicity, depends upon the whatever it may be. Then if you can go for the formulation, you can do oral, non-oral, injectable, dose, repeated dose administration, whatever you want to do, you can do. Then you can do fasting study, fed study. Even here, you can if you know the genomic profile of that particular group, you can embed the genomic profile which is reflect in the genetic expressions level. And the genetic expression level of that particular protein, for example, if the enzymes expressions will be different in different organs in the different genomic setup. So that is very easy to capture your problems. So this is the case study wherein you don't have anything with you, still you can develop a reasonably decent model of predicting the human food effect, interference of diseases like congestive cardiac failure, wherein you will get the cardiac output will be very different, you can able to find out. Next slide, please. In case study three, this is very, very interesting because you can manipulate the metabolizing enzymes, you can manipulate the total hepatic clearance based on the specific population. Suppose the population has a different metabolism like inducer, inhibitor, autoinduction, concomitant and administration of one drug. It's a kind of pharmacokinetic metabolic interactions. All those things you can able to find out. Even in the similar fate, transportation proteins like OAT, OCAT, and MDP, PGP, all these things can be done. Whatever you feel you can able to do. This is the PK sim software, which is available free of cost in open source pharmacology. You can download that particular software. Probably it takes very less space at the beginning. Then what you can do is that there is a lot of presentations are available how to operate. So today my intention is not how to operate, my intention is what to put where and why. That is very important. So you have almost 20-25 videos are available. Yes, a 800 page document how to utilize the PK sim you can use, and it is freely available. And if you want to data, you can take the data from the reputed publications, especially the innovator publication. For example, the molecule is invented by whom, whether it is AstraZeneca or GSK, whoever may be, you can take. So the here you can change everything based on the disease physiology you can able to make. Next slide, please. Case study 4 is a very, very interesting thing. For example, I understand the drug substances. I understand the one of the parameter, whether it may be a drug substances parameter, that is the physicochemical properties of the drug substances, or it may be the physicochemical properties of the formulation. For example, surface tension, density, viscosity, osmolarity of the formulation in case of liquid formulation, or in case of solid formulation, hardness, disintegration, whatever it may be. So what the parameter sensitive analysis is that we talked about the critical quality attributes to understand that particular quality attribute is critical or not. For example, you take a 100. Suppose if you take me, I have a 100 quality attributes. Maybe I'm working in formulation. Maybe I'm teaching. Maybe I'm in industry. Maybe I'm in I read Tamil books or whatever it may be. 100 quality attributes, which is the predominant quality attribute of mine, is very important, because that will dominate my life, that will dominate my lifestyle, that will dominate the society. So there are 100 material attributes, quality attributes, process attributes. In that 100 attributes, which is critical to quality, you have to identify. One of the in silico tool is that parameter sensitive analysis. Parameter sensitive analysis will give which tool is, which quality attribute is critical. For example, if you see the graph, if you see the graph implies that the Cmax value of the dosage form depends on the solubility of the suspension. So if you are increasing the solubility, your Cmax value increases. If you are not increasing, if you want to, if for example here my intention is I want to get a 350 nanogram Cmax, then I have to titrate my solubility to 3.3 microgram per ml. It's as simple as. So the selected quality attribute is Cmax here. Selected critical material or process attribute is particles is parameter sensitive analysis and validate using the experimental data. It is as simple as. You can put Cmax versus AUC also possible. What is the influence of Cmax and AUC? What is the influence of Cmax on therapeutic outcome? What is the influence of Cmax on adverse drug reaction? Anything and everything you can model using the parameter sensitive analysis. This will give you, is there any direct relationship or not? If at all, if there is a direct relationship, how strong the relationship is, whether it's a very strong relationship or weak relationship in terms of regression line. If it is a very strong relationship, whether that relationship is useful or useless. Probably there may be a relationship. It may not be useless. It may be useless relationship. That time we have to ignore. Next slide, please. So, next slide. So, the understanding is that every software, especially when you are working on physiologically based biopharmaceutical modeling, you should know the pharmacotechnical properties of that particular drug product you are administering. Because most of the time, biopharmaceutical models are built based on the pharmacotechnical properties of the dosage form rather than the drug substances inherent behavior. One such a case is that, for example, metformin, hydrochloride. It's a highly soluble drug. So the highly soluble drug, it's a BCS class 3 drug. It has a one, there is no solubility issue. Hence, it will give you a rapid onset and whatever it may be. Now, when you make the metformin with extended release formulation, the metformin property of high solubility is manipulated by the rate controlling polymers, hydrophilic polymers or hydrophobic polymers. So if you give the input matter, input parameter, metformin property, you will fail in your model development. What you have to do is that you have to put appropriate parameters, which is the final parameter. We are not going to administer a drug. We are going to administer it as a dosage form. So you have to put dosage form property than drug property. But when you are developing an IV model, when you are developing an IR model, that depends upon the number of factors.
So when, what is a good in vitro tool to characterize the formulation or pharmacotechnical properties are particle size measurement, maybe microscopy, laser diffraction, and dynamic light scattering. A number of techniques are available for then you can see the particle size in dosage form. Sometimes I put a D90 of 10 micron during the process may resulted with kind of grinding which may be resulted differently. So the optical microscopic techniques and chemical imaging techniques like FTIR, FPA, like focal plane array, or Raman chemical imaging techniques are available, wherein you can able to map the particle size of the API in the formulation, which is very, very important. And most of the time, people wherein the particle size dependent, that means surface area dependent solubility, and hence influence of the Cmax and other valuable PK metrics is influenced by majorly people take into the account of the particle size of the input particle API. But whereas here you have to do is that you should know the what is the particle size of the API which is being present in the formulation. So that is very, very important. These are all the small tips, and the crystalline behavior is similar. People go for a XRD, like a powder XRD or single crystal XRD, probably very less relevant into the pharmaceutical formulation, unless otherwise you are making a kind of a nano formulations, a nano crystal formulations, which are being directly administered into the intravenous route, wherein you might be having an ability to, the morphology and topology of the nanoparticle system, which influences the, that means crystallization behavior, which influences the like a pathological physiological process like phagocytosis and Kupffer cell uptake and all those things. So for that it is required. Generally we generally prefer to have a powder XRD. We generally prefer to the small angle XRD. Temperature variant XRD is once again a very good tool, wherein you because we are making the formulations at ambient conditions of 25 degrees Celsius, whereas it is administered at 37 degrees Celsius. There is a case, there is a evidence that temperature induced the crystallization behavior and polymorphic changes which occur during the formulation development and as well as in the gastrointestinal tract, especially in stomach, in presence of the hydrochloric acid. There is an acid solubilization followed by the seed formation, then surface mediated crystallization, which takes place in the crystals, which change the crystal habits in the in situ crystal, in vivo crystallization, precipitation kinetics happen in the stomach, which may influence. Like a thermal behavior, like you can calculate the Gibbs free energy, and you can calculate the melting endothermic, which can be directly correlated. I mean to say that the thermal behaviors like DSE is more oftenly used as a orthogonal technique, which supplements the dissolution methodology. That is what, and it has a lot of applications. But you should have the idea of doing different techniques and making your formulation characterization is the moment if you understand your formulation in a better way, then there is a possibly a very good possibility for getting a very good correlation and very good model development. The model which you develop is a truly mechanistic model.
so that you, if you manipulate anything, and you will get a desired outcome in future. Then surface area is also one very important. Wherever there is a possibility of nano sizing, because in gastro plus you can put the nano sizing effect, but the surface area, sometimes when you do the nano sizing, there is a monolayer air formation which will reduce the effective surface area. Thereby you can have a misleaded model, so you have to adjust the model based on your surface area to particle size. That are all the things which needs to be done. That can be done by dynamic light scattering laser diffraction, low frequency NMR, and helium replacement technique. You can choose any technique that is in your choice, but you should fundamentally know why you are choosing the technique, what is the impact of that. Next slide, please. Then you can do the kind of acid resistance. This is more pertaining to the oral drug delivery, like pH modulation, buffer modulation, pre-treatment, ionic strength, then matrix behavior, small volume DTs, and DT in high viscosity, especially when you are developing a colonic dosage form, wherein the dosage form is intact till when it reaches to the ileocecal junction, so that you know the where you are doing the conventional 900 ml dissolution method may not be useful, because the colonic volume is somewhere around 9 to 13 ml, which may have a very different activity. So that is very important. And the matrix integrity is very important in terms of not only oral administration, and some extent it is very useful for ocular pharmacokinetics and as well as intramuscular pharmacokinetics. Whereas in intramuscular pharmacokinetics, I mean to say that subsequently it forms a biological matrix, and which is very important, that needs to be worked out. But whereas in case of oral drug delivery, the especially controlled release formulations, the matrix integrity can be challenged by a number of parameters, physiological parameters and physicochemical parameters of the gastric fluid, including the pH, ionic strength, buffering capacity, and hydrodynamics, that needs to be studied. Because most of the time, the modified release product fails because of the matrix integrity. If your model is failing for modified release problem, there is the likely good chances of the matrix integrity, you might be missed out, and that is the reason it is getting failed. And the next slide, please. So the special techniques like changeover methods for delayed release product and simultaneous dissolution permeation methods are also available, like TMO methods and artificial stomach and so method. See, my personal philosophy is you make a method very simple, reliable, reproducible. The more and more complex in the method, the method related variables will increase, then you have to control those variables. So it's something very, you know, hazy, and to get it into the very complex method, first thing for any person, whether it is an in vitro method or ex vivo method or maybe whatever the method, it should be a very simple basic method. Most of the time, simple method work very well than the complex methods. Next slide, please. So based on the different formulation, then you require a lipoprotein binding studies. This is very, very important for some of the nanoparticulate system being administered intravenously, wherein the lipoproteins which are present in the plasma, which get binds into that, and wherein it alter the tissue pharmacokinetics, distribution pharmacokinetics of that particular intravenous. So that is also very important. Then bile lecithin dissolution is very important for BCS class 4 molecules, and as well as the drug delivery technologies being developed with the kind of dosage forms such as SMEADs and non-aqueous drug delivery system, all those things are very important. Then lipolysis is generally used for SMEADs and oily preparation, wherein your drug is dissolved or embedded into the oil matrix, wherein the oil lipolysis, that means all oil digestion is very, very important. Then swelling index, you have the number of parameters like powder dissolution and also. Next slide, please. This is the case study 5. This is one of the very interesting story, how the contact angle will impact the many people ask Rajkumar, we don't have the differences in the dissolution kinetics, but still we are failing in bio. So that is the reason you should not only rely on the dissolution. For example, the dissolution which is cited here in this particular slide, probably the dissolution is same if you use optometric technique. Probably the dissolution is same if you skip 20 minutes and 30 minutes time point. Directly if you do 6 minutes, 1 hour time profile, it is same. So always profiling is better. More number of time points in profile will give the better clarity of your shape factor of the dissolution. That is also very important. And in addition to that, you should have a one orthogonal method should differentiate the two formulation in line with the dissolution. For example, here the higher the contact angle, low wettability. That is what, you know, the square which is filled dark black squares, which is having that lower the contact angle, much better wettability. So you here you are having a two method, not only the dissolution and as well as the contact angle of the. It's a very simple experiment you can do with a kind of glass surface and tablet. Put one drop of ink onto that, take the pick and print out. Make a, you know, x-axis, make the angle, you put y-axis and x-axis and make the angle represent the contact angle. It doesn't cost much, but you know, it give lot of insights. So what I mean to say is that you go and be work with as very, very simple models. Contact angle is something not a very great, very expensive tool, but that will give the luxury to leverage your thought process in such a way that you will get more confidence when you are putting a DISO in either gastro or PK. Okay, PKSIM. Next slide, please. For example, this is one of the very interesting state. Two formulation, one has higher dissolution and another has the lower dissolution. Higher dissolution is having the lower bioavailability. Lower dissolution is having the higher bioavailability. This is what generally we see in most of the amorphous drug delivery system, wherein the drug polymeric matrix is incorporated, where the polymer is enabled to prevent the recrystallization of the weakly basic drug, especially weakly basic drug goes into the solution at acidic pH, and when it turns into the precipitate in the near neutral pH, especially in the intestine. So this is a kind of correlation. So here, what many people do, people tweak the dissolution method. But the idea is that not tweaking the dissolution method, tweaking your precipitation kinetics in the relevant software and get it into the in vivo precipitation, which is built in the software, and get the similar results. I believe that you people understand it is not tweaking the dissolution. It is the tweaking the mechanistically tweaking the understanding where the precipitation takes place. Then you tweak the GI physiology, compartment, pH, then get it into the same level of crystallization, which you can see the in vivo release profile. You will get a very deep and very sharp deep dip in the release profile, percentage release profile, especially when the dosage form or dosage form material is introduced into the intestine. Next slide, please. Many people, the one of the very interesting, maybe this is the primitive to talk about the impact of the buffer strength, but out of curiosity and the scientific weightage, you know, I would like to discuss this case study of 7. Many people think when I ask the people during the interaction, what is your method? People say it's a 6.8 phosphate buffer. whether it is sodium phosphate, whether it is a potassium phosphate, whether it is with 50 millimolar, 10 millimolar, 5 millimolar, or the altogether other pH 6.8 buffer that needs to be identified with bile, without bile, with. So one of the very interesting thing, most of the time, if you see the gastrointestinal physiology, the buffer is a mild buffer. It's, I think, a carbonic acid bicarbonate buffer, which is present in the, I mean to say, the intestine, which is a very, very mild buffer. But whereas we are using a phosphate buffer, which is very strong buffer. The estimated buffering capacity in vivo healthy human subject is somewhere around 60 mol to 15 mol, depends upon their food habit, exercise, climate, so on. But the default buffer which we use is 90 millimolar, 50 millimolar phosphate. So that is not an absolute idea. So this is not required for most of the formulation. Somehow this needs to be taken into the account when you are developing the dissolution media. For example, in this case study, if you are using 6.25 millimolar buffer, your solubility is 51 microgram per ml, whereas if you use 100, it is 5.8. So probably here the biorelevancy can be achieved with 12.5 millimolar buffer. Next slide, please. This is the case study wherein the in vitro chemical imaging, what we have discussed earlier, a part of this presentation, how to find out the particle size distribution, especially in BCS class 2 drug and BCS class 4 drugs, to understand, for example, if you see the input API particle size remains same, but whereas if you see the innovator, it is a completely amorphous and the particle sizes are less than 3 micron, but whereas in generic product we have a lot of bulk particles. This may be agglomerates. Even in agglomerates, kind of agglomerates, results in the surface area impact. It impacts the surface area, especially effective surface area, and results in the different thing. Next slide, please. So the in vivo tools, so far we have discussed the in vitro tools. In vivo tools, I'm not going to be in big details, but as an academic interest, I will put it into that. Whenever you are doing any project, you go for the all the set of clinical data from phase zero, like a kind of microdosing and radio labeling study, phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four, and bioavailability studies with the different dosage forms, bioequivalent studies which are reported. All these things to be, you have to take all the data because this data is very easy to develop and generate. Okay. That means it is very easy to generate that rather than developing this data. So do the complete literature search of in vivo tools, which is going to be very, very useful for you. So as far as in vivo tools, my suggestion, go ahead with the completely dependent, literature dependent work. You can take it and make it the things to be done. Then probably this is the IVIVC people, you might be knowing the in vitro in vivo correlation. That means there is a physical chemical properties are relevant to the pharmacokinetic properties. It's a mathematical model to establish the relationship between the in vitro and in vivo performance. And 1996, this is the concept paper was published by Vinod Pisha and et al. And subsequently, it is adopted by USFDA and further it is adopted by EMA and all those things. So the biopharmaceutical classification system is a very good tool, not only for the generic product development and product development, but also the new drug discovery process. Now the biopharmaceutical classification system and IVIVC go beyond their applications, and the way people are working about the biopharmaceutical disposition models and clearance and the metabolic extraction ratios were incorporated. But however, the basic biopharmaceutical models and based on IVAVC remains a very, very interesting tool. For example, next slide, please. These are all the in vitro tools like a dissolution. Next slide, please. In vitro tools like a dissolution, drug release, particle size, and all those things are very, very important. The in vivo is something like a Cmax AUC, partial AUC, etc. Next slide, please. next slide. I can able to hear you. Hello. Hello. I'm audible.
Audible. It's audible, sir. We can continue. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes, sir. It is audible. We can continue, sir. Thank you.
Next slide, please. Next slide, please.
Okay, sir.
So the IVIVC and IVIVR is based on the parameters like in vitro dissolution parameters like dissolution, drug release, particle size, permeation rate constant, wettability, polymorphism. These are all the in vitro parameters being optimized, whereas in vivo parameters such as Cmax, AUC, partial AUC, Tmax, Tlag, and all those things, whatever which is very, very important. That is what the concept of the, the synthesis of clinically relevant quality target profile came into the picture, and wherein people started working on to that. Maybe years together, we can able to get the one of the parameter of certificate of analysis in COA. What is the clinically relevant method? Is at least fasting method needs to be incorporated, and people are working for that particular aspect as well. The understanding IVIVC is a very simple concept. It's a mathematical model, and the very interesting thing is that you require a biopharmaceutical concepts like biorelevant dissolution methodologies are required. Very good pharmacokinetic data is required, and you can able to develop. I will go quickly through the next step. I mean to say that please be with the slide number 31. Slide number 31 describes that the dissolution models, because IVIVC is the combination of dissolution, and that is what predominantly used in vitro and as well as in vivo. So there are number of models are available. For example, zero order, first order, second order, hexicron model, Higuchi, PEPAS, and logistic, Kumpfer, PEPAS, so many models are available. But what is the use of these models? Why we have to use these models is very, very important, because these models will able to give the predictability at any point of time. So you have to have a very good dissolution data and dissolution model. Come back to the slide number 32. Slide number 32 implies that how to develop the model. For example, from screening to selection to reproducibility, robustness, in within and between the data analysis, statistical treatment, and application. Pharmacokinetic model, which I'm not going to be in detail, because you people know about the different pharmacokinetics models like one compartment, two compartment, three compartment, PBPK, whole PBPK and all. Slide number 34 implies that the requirement of the PBPK model. If at all, if you want to develop the PBPK model, physicochemical properties of the drug substances is the first prerequisite. This is in the slide number 34. Requirement of PBPK is physicochemical properties of the drug substances, formulation properties, that means pharmacotechnical properties are very, very important, GA physiological parameters are very, very important, and PBPK is very important. Slide number 35 will give the model input data, which is derived from the literature search for GastroPlus. We have to get all this information, for example, from molecular weight, pH dependent solubility, log D, pKa. Once if you make the table like this, your job is very, very easy. If anybody want to build the model, you can freely contact me. If there is no commercial interest, only for academic and research purpose, I will help you people. So this is the table which we have to generate at the time of that thing. Then the slide number 36 is a flow chart. Slide number 36 is a flow chart. It is from construction of PK model from human PK data available, deconvolution of various different dosage forms, at least six different dosage forms to be required if you want to validate from the literature, and you can follow the subsequent procedure. Slide number 37. This is the slide which I like because you see the EST unique gene, RT-PCR array. These are all the gene expression database. When you want to develop your true PBPK model, this is the basis for you. These are all freely available. You download and process it and take it. And this is very, very important. For example, the basic PK model, extended PBPK model, then gene, that means very detailed oriented PBPK model with tissue expressions and enzyme expressions. Slide number 38 is once again, I like this slide always. Whenever the molecule comes, I make this mass balance equation. How much amount of the drug is administered, how it is getting absorbed, all those parameters. This slide number 37 and 38 is very important. You have to follow for your drug molecule similar way, 37 and 38. Now, slide number 39 discuss about the PK model development. Slide number 40 reveals the deconvolution procedure. For example, it may be a mechanistic deconvolution, maybe conventional deconvolution. But what I mean to say is that you start with a very, very simple Wagner-Nielsen method. Then you can go to Luhr-Eagleman method. Then you can go for a Bayesian approach or and a numerical deconvolution method. Finally, you come to PBPK. Whenever you want to try, because sometimes that means 15% of the molecule wherein you will get a very good correlation with one compartmental Wagner-Nielsen method. So why you have to break your head and making and developing a very complex model if there is no absolute need for that? So the slide number 40 is very important for choosing. Slide number 41 is the case study. Most of the people may be probably developing different formulation setup, like a mouth dissolving tablet to colonic delivery to time dependent release, whatever it may be. There is a four scenario. First one is a rapid release. Second one is a multiphasic release. That means IR plus ER kind of formulation. The third one is colon targeting, wherein our chronotherapeutics in case of attention deviated hyperactivity syndrome, this concerta kind of formulations to develop. And the scenario four is the prolonged release exposure. So this is the case study. I mean to say, before you are starting your formulation development activities, you should know what is your quality target product profile in terms of plasma drug concentration versus time profile. This is very, very important. So the case study 41 is very important. Case study 42 is the biodiscriminatory method to get the biowaiver approach. That is what about the PBPK model. I will put it into the one case study of ritual bioequivalence, which is done by the USFDA. This is the USFDA published study. I will go back to the next slide, please. So this is the USFDA published study, virtual bioequivalence. I don't have any access. This is not my intellectual property or something like that. This is freely available. You can download the complete paper. Slide number 44. Next slide. So the warfarin is one of the very critical drug. Many people know it's an antiplatelet drug, which is used in the coronary and cerebral embolism and kind of myocardial infarct and post myocardial infarct people and cerebrovascular accident people. That drug is prescribed, and it's a very narrow therapeutic index, and it has the pKa value of 5.5, exhibit pH dependent solubility. And the very interesting for part is that it is available in a pseudo polymer called as clarithet of the warfarin sodium isopropyl alcohol complex. This complex, which is exposed to higher temperature by IPA being a volatile material, it is getting evaporated. Hence, the warfarin free base is getting there and it is getting amorphous. So, most of the time, amorphous drugs are having better solubility, but whereas it is not the true with the pseudo polymorphism. In case of pseudo polymorphism, because of the affinity to the hydrogen bonding affinity to the pseudopolymorphism to the water, especially in dissolution media, which give the higher resolution. But whereas the moment if we remove the IPA, there is a fairly enough chances of the solubility declines. The IPA evaporation and formation of the amorphous form is based on the humidity and temperature. This drug is an emergency drug and it is asked to keep even in bathrooms when the people get the kind of angina or some kind of a syndrome wherein there is an embolic attack. It kept in bathroom. While you are keeping in the bathroom is a high humid, high temperature area wherein the conversion of IPA clarithet to amorphous form takes place. And that is the reason amorphous form is less soluble, especially in 1.2, 4.5 and 6.8. And it's a narrow therapeutic index drug. That means if at all, if there is a small fluctuation in plasma drug concentration, may result in the failure of the therapy, or it shows the adverse drug reaction. And hence, the aim of the thing is that when the conversion happen, there is a dip in the dissolution profile, especially in 4.5 and 6.8. So the FDA itself investigated this issue, whether these pHs of dissolutions are really biorelevant or not. So the RLD is cumarin 5 mg by Bristol Myers Squibb. Next slide, please. The both test products are of a generic company. Confirmation was made. Next slide. Confirmation was made on loss of crystallinity by XRD and IPA content of the two oral the quality attributes to define the product with IPA crystallinate form and with amorphous form. Next slide, please. So the software used is SimSip and S Plus, Gastro Plus. These are all the input material. Next slide, please. Then virtual bioequivalence studies were conducted with a total number of 1,200 subjects. Each BE trials, 30 subjects were randomly selected, and 100 total number of trials were 100. The CMAX AUC, all the criteria, it's a kind of a average bioequivalence study was performed with the 90% CE of 80 to 125 for all the PK metrics. And a reference scale bioequivalence is also performed based on the requirement. Next slide, please. Now I'm in slide number 49. This is the grouping sequence of the bioequivalence study. This is a virtual bioequivalence study. Then the slide 50, which demonstrated the dissolution efficacy at different pH. Slide 50, dissolution different pH, which shows that there is a differences in the different products which are stored in different conditions and different temperature and upon different time, which shows clearly there is a chances of dissolution dropping in 4.5 pH. So if you go to the 51 slide, if you see that the PK matrix table, it is absolutely irrespective of the dissolution drop down, it is bioequivalent. The product is meeting the bioequivalence criteria of 80 to 125 with the 90% confidence interval, and the T/R ratios are well within the very good. Like it ranges from 0.972 to 1.007. That is nothing but 97.9% bioequivalency with 100.9. So the next slides, please. So this is what the predictions were made based on the in vivo data. The prediction shows that there is a kind of very good model development because the observed value is very close to the predicted value. So what is the take home message? Next slide, please. Take home message from the publication is that no need to, it is not only give the virtual bioequivalence, not only give the regulatory acceptance and comfortability of what to do and what not to do and how to tweak and control your parameters, especially when you are going for the dissolution kinetics and dissolution release profile. But also, one of the very interesting thing is that it will also help you to find out the false negative value. False negative is once again a very big issue which impacts the quality, cost to the quality, and manufacturer loss, huge revenue loss. So this study, the conversion of crystalline of amorphous was confirmed. Yes, there is a change in the polymorphic form. Dissolutions were lower, that is also active. But the lower dissolution and polymorph which not have any impact on the the 6.8 dissolution media can be bioirrelevant media, because 4.5 is a super discriminatory. 1.2 may not cover the entire range of pH. We can keep it. This is what the FDA's conclusion is. Next slide, please. So we came into the final summary. 20 years of research in in silico methods brought number of platforms and understanding and regulatory scientists and intellectual communities thought process. Human brain cannot be replaced. This is what I want to say to everyone. Human brain is still an integral part of any product development or any activity. The computational simulation, artificial intelligence, along with the machine learning will help, will speed up, will accelerate the process. But the major stakeholder is human brain. So many people have the false thought process saying that if we have a computational chemistry, we can do everything. No, there is a technique called as garbage in, garbage out. You put your garbage inside the any in silico tool, you will get it garbage out. So it's a kind of rapidity, and it is upcoming field, so it is very useful tool. And this will change the pharmaceutical product development probably a decade after or before. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity. I would like to thank once again the college management, principal, and staff members, especially Suchitra Madam, for giving me this opportunity. And at last, but not least, I would also thank all the participants who has a lot of patience and, to share my thought process on the same. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Excuse me, sir. Hello, sir. Is I audible, sir?
Yeah, you are audible.
Thank you, sir. It's a very great session we have encountered today. Sir, we have some questions from participants. Some questions, so we will
Look
after those. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. I will project directly to the screen, sir. You can directly read from the screen.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Sir, can you be able to see the screen, sir, now?
No. I can able to see now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Could you please explain... this question is from Ram SG.
Yes, sir.
Could you please explain the precautions and explain the importance aspect to carry out procedure, a pharmacokinetic study for new combination in transdermal route of atenolol and glibenclamide? See, the question is very simple. They developed a new combination product and entirely new dosage form, transdermal. I believe that atenolol and glibenclamide is not available in the thing. First of all, what is my suggestion? Going directly the pharmacokinetic study is not possible, especially in India, like country wherein your dermal characteristics are very different from summer to winter to monsoon. So first thing is that pharmacokinetic studies for transdermal application, India is not the right place, especially in academic setup, because you don't have a controlled room temperature. If your perception, that means your sweat, you sweat, second thing is that this, you work on atenolol and glibenclamide and compile the structural property relationship. first of all, what is the thermal absorption of these two molecules based on the in silico methodology, and explore whether it is feasible to do the feasible to do to develop this formulation. My belief is it's very difficult for these two molecules. However, if any new technology or entirely something a very great innovation probably allowed to deliver these two molecules through transdermal route. At this point of time, my personal belief is no need to think about pharmacokinetic studies. You compile and make a stable patch, first of all. It's very difficult to load. I believe that atenolol is 10 milligram. So it's very difficult to load, very load with a small patch. So it is, first you do all the groundwork. Pharmacokinetics will come after at least another 5 years. So you focus on more into formulation development and develop the human cadaver skin permeability. Then we will see how it is going to work. And without data, without in vitro data and formulation characteristics, it is very difficult to tell which is the best detailed procedures, because protocol is always depends upon the formulation characterization, because you have to pick up the Cmax, AUC, etc. Next question, please.
Yes, sir. Excuse me, sir. Can you adjust your camera once? Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. One more question, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, question from Marquez, sir. It's how to
fix up the parameter using this. Question from RK, good information. How to fix up the parameter using the software to optimize your formulation? This is once again very, very good question. A struggle in initial phase of their life when they are started with modeling and simulation. My suggestion is one should go with the well developed PBPK model. You put those model parameter and you rerun the program. When you rerun the program, you will get the same result. Then you tweak small parameter. At least first 1 to 2 months, you not try to develop a new model working with the old model, which is a very good model. Then you will get a lot of experience how to get the optimization. Next yes, question, sir. Please.
Yes, sir.
Recommend some softwares for academic research. This is what I said. You can go for PKSIM, which is open source pharmacology, along with the MoBio. These are all the softwares which will give the very good. There are number of softwares. You can go with that depends upon your requirement. For example, you can go ahead with the simple Excel-based add-on programs are also available. So I don't know the level where you are, but you can start with a simple one, like a PK solver, then add on to it, and even you can program it in R. Then finally, you can go for PBPK model. The recommendation for software is based on what is your basic,
yes, sir.
What is your platform, what is your background. If you have a very strong background, even you can go and ask evaluation license for any of the reputed softwares which probably might be interested give for academication purpose. So getting the software is not a bottleneck at all for anyone, whether they are in industry or academics. The problem is that, you have to go step by step from a Excel-based program, then keep on increasing your complexity and reach the level wherein you can have your own model to build in terms of whatever you want, you can build it, because a lot of open source platforms are available even to build the software. It's not a problem here. The problem here is understanding the basic concepts and working from the scratch is very, very important. And it's a very time-consuming process, at least 10 years required, if somebody want to be expert in biopharmaceutics, with all given support and facilities. Maybe, yes, maybe it may be very, very bright students, faculties, probably it may require at least 5 years. So you have to go through a very, very systematic approach, no shortcuts. All shortcuts will result hampering your learning program and you will get frustrated. So first of all, my perception is that you don't ask anything to anyone. Go and do your own search and you will get a lot of surprises. See, I'm not something greater than Google, right?
Yes.
So yes, go and search, keep on searching, 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 you will find. And you, when you are questioning to something, you have very specific question wherein you will, only the subject matter expert can help you to resolve that problem. Because some of the very specific questions, it is very difficult for Google to answer. Wherein the subject matter expert can help to resolve that issue. Next slide, next question, please.
Sir, question from Vijayalakshmi. Suggest in vitro absorption models for a new molecule.
What is the molecule? What is its structure? Yes, what is its physicochemistry?
Yes, sir. One more question.
How we are going to make... Nothing wrong in that. Next question, please.
Yes, sir. Sorry. This is the question, sir.
Okay, we will share.
That's okay, sir. This is the questions.
Any limit for vaccine? It's a very good question.
Yes.
There are macromolecule PBK. There are models, probably peptides and proteins, such as MAB and insulin and KEPON. And some of the PBPK modeling are also available for, it's not actually PBPK modeling, it's a physiological models which are available for vaccine as well to understand how to predict the efficacy of vaccine. But it is not the scope of my work. I have never worked in vaccine. My work is related to small molecules, some extent protein, peptide molecule, which is having less than 3000 Dalton molecular weight. But it's I saw some of the papers for that, wherein you can model the vaccine as well. And in fact, you can vaccine anything and everything in the world. Not only vaccine, you can model anything and everything, any molecule, any stereotypes and all. Thank you.
Yes, sir, we have one question from Sucharita, ma'am. I will ask. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir. It was an amazing presentation, really. You just delivered like as how we were discussed regarding this computational models. Truly, truly amazing presentation, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you. So I have one
Go
question.
Go ahead with sir. Your question, madam. Yes, madam.
Yeah, how to deal with the outliers? When we are developing a mechanistic model, there are a lot of outliers.
Yeah, and this is the very... Yeah, in mechanistic modeling, there is no question of outlier because you know why the outlier is because of their demography or because of concomitant food administration or modification, or we can clearly identify. See, there are things which are very useful. When you know the patient demography completely and if you develop the mechanistic PBPK model, whereas the predicted value is something very different from the observed value, and the predicted value of the population is very similar to the observed value of the population, then you can justify that particular outlier using your mechanistic PBPK model. However, there is no regulatory clarity on this aspect. As on that, for example, it is very simple and easy to say statistical outlier. For example, you can do Lund's test, or you can do something like a T-test. You can do the 2.5 standard deviation cutoff, and you can take the 3 standard deviation cutoff. There are a number of methodologies are available to understand whether the outlier is a statistical outlier or numerical outlier. But you to understand the true outlier because of the subject by formulation interaction. That is very, very important in any outlier understanding, whether this is the because of that particular subject interacted with that particular formulation in a different way. That is the reason the results were very different from the population. Then in that particular case, PBPK model will help you to justify this particular outlier is not because of the subject by formulation interaction. Then there is a question come whether it is not because of the subject, then it is not because of the formulation, then there is a chances of bioanalytical issue. If it is not a bioanalytical issue, issues are well accounted. One can easily find out the bioanalytical issues, those who are in subject matter experts. So if there is no bioanalytical issue, there is no subject, then that particular tablet or dosage form is not manufactured according to the specification. But the question for you, when you are developing a mechanistic PBPK model, you take as maximum as data with a wide variability, including the outlier. Even including the outlier, if you have a one outlier, which may have an impact on when you are running the program with 50 subjects. When you run the program with 100 subjects, 200 subjects, 300 subjects, 500 subjects, and 1,000 subjects, at one point of time, your outlier impact will be very minimum, or there is no statistically significant impact of outlier on study outcome.
Okay.
So no need to bother about the outliers. Only you have to power the study to minimize that outlier. Next.
Okay.
Thank you for this good question.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Sunil, any more questions? Can I go further?
You can go for wind up, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. It's my privilege to present a thank note to our eminent speaker, that is Dr. Rajkumar, sir. Sir, it was a truly amazing presentation, and especially you have shared a knowledge of mechanistic models and PBPK models, and also how to design a model, how to go for the parameter sensitivity analysis, how to interpret a model, and how to go for the IVC in dissolutions as well as the kinetic establishments. You just explored all your 16 years of experience in designing the PBPK models and the computation simulations in pharmacokinetics. You just shared in a 1 hour or 1.5 hour presentation, very lucid presentation. I was just very impressed and truly honored to have you here in our college EFTP program. And I request you to support us and to help us in our future endeavors also. And we'll be in contact with you for further research developments from our college side. And I request you to support us in future also, sir.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot for joining with
us.
Thank you. So all the delegates, the feedback link for this sessions, day 1, day 2, and day 3 will be provided on tomorrow, that is July 19th, after the valedictory. And the feedback link will be activated on whole day so that you can submit your feedback on the 3-day EFTP program. And after submitting the feedback, you can avail your e-certificate. Thank you for joining into this 3-day EFTP program. I request you to join for day 3, that is by Dr. Muralidharan sir, and he's going to give a complete understanding of JMP software and how to input all those parameters in JMP software and how to interpret the data and how to design or develop a drug molecule using a JMP software. So please join into the day 3 program and don't miss it. And thank you for joining all the delegates. Hope we are meeting your expectations. See you tomorrow. Happy learning. Stay home and stay safe. Bye, sir. Thank you so much.